After a district final appearance in the 83-84 season, Mansfield Sr. was primed for a stellar season coming into the 85 campaign.
Well, I had high expectations because we had everybody back, you know, so we were looking to have a great year.
We didn't realize how good I think we were or could be. Nobody was really telling us. Coach Pratts and Coach Lanier did a really good job of that. You're not as good as you think you are. Okay, so just understand that.
Because I remember the summer of 84, we was playing at Maple Lake Park then. Mm-hmm. And we all played as a team, you know. If you had winners, we all picked each other. And we had a hell of a summer.
Although they were a good team on paper, the 85 Tigers struggled out of the gate, starting with a home opening loss to their arch rival Malabar.
When we started the season off, we was horrible. I mean, horrible. We had lost like what, 4 or 5 games. But Coach Pratt was just letting us do what, you know, we wanted to do. Then he stepped in. And then that's when we took off. We didn't lose no more games.
Because you referenced the 5-5 start. That's one of the things I remember was they weren't strong to start with. It took them a while to gel. And I wish I could remember what game it was. And I had never heard Joe Pratts do this before. And I wasn't in the locker room. It was a closed, but he just reamed those guys after and I could hear him outside the locker room. And Joe always seemed to me to be, you know, a pretty cool customer. He didn't seem to be a guy that would, you know, throw furniture in the locker room or anything like that. But this was a change for me. That's a dominant memory for me, is standing outside, listening through that closed door as he just really, really went after those guys in a way I'd never heard before. And I don't recall that I'd ever heard since. To your question about whether I thought they were going to make a run, not really.
Well, we just sat down, you know, and wanted to get some focus and some structure amongst ourselves because we knew we had a great team, a good team. Everybody played their positions and their roles. But, you know, you still had a little bit of, you know, little animosity sometimes, not, you know, a little selfishness sometimes with the ball. Like somebody might have a fast break and somebody could miss, but you know, you could have passed it, but you didn't, you know. So we had these things, but at that meeting, I can say, you know, we just really put our heads together and just say, hey man, we got to do something.
Meanwhile, exactly 3.8 miles away, the Mansfield Malabar Falcons were cruising through the season. Undefeated and barely challenged, the Falcons seemed to be the area's only hope for a long postseason run.
Going into the season, David had just moved in Montrose, and we had just seen him start to blend with the guys, and we didn't know what to expect. You know, we thought we would be good, we thought we could win quite a bit, but it was bigger things that group had to do that they were motivated by. And as far as that group goes, I think we always had confidence in them. They played very good defense. They were a good defensive-minded unit, and we were very, very balanced in scoring. We had Melvin and Andre, you know, they would get their 15. We had Fella and Eugene around that 10, 11-point mark, and David was around that 12-point mark. So, you know, it worked out very well. Did we expect to go to Columbus? We thought there was a good shot.
Honestly, we didn't know because Steve Martinette was our big man. He had left to go to Bowling Green, so that was a big hole for us to fill. You know, 16 points, 10 rebounds, and was pretty much the leader of the team. I just remember that summer, Melvin and I spent a lot of time talking to Coach about what he wanted from us as a returning backcourt. We got real fortunate that David Montrose moved in, and even though he was only 6'2", his jumping ability was made up for whatever he had. People don't realize he played 4 years volleyball at Ohio State and was all but 10. And we just started playing with him and understanding he could fit.
Yeah.
He wasn't Steve. We knew Andre had to give us more scoring. Eugene and myself had to pick up some slack. But I knew we would be more athletic than we were in the school.
I remember them guys always seemed to look like it was so easy. It was they seemed to have so much fun. They, you know, I remember Mel and Andre, you know, one of them would score a basket, the other one would come down and they would be like laughing. To see them compete on the high level like they competed and then have time to, you know, hey man, I got him that time. Yeah, check it out. You know, it was amazing, man. It was an amazing time to be a fan of basketball in Mansfield at that time period.
Midway through what was supposed to be a positive season for the Tygers, Pratt's Cats were 5-5 after 10 games. But after a disappointing loss against local rival Lexington and a heated players-only meeting, the Tygers were roaring again. Tigers went on to win 8 of their last 9 games and entered the tournament as one of the hottest teams in the area. At 13-7, the early season losses had hurt them in the seeding process. And when the teams were seeded, the Tigers were left out of the top-tier teams and left with the option to play a weaker bracket or go after the top seed.
We were not seeded in the sectional, and we had one of the middle pills, and I told my coaches, we discussed it, who do we want to play, and I said, well, let's play the number one seed.
Going into the tournament for me was great because I had already kind of started doing this scoring thing, because I had like 30 points like maybe once or twice before the end of the season, like these last two games, like I was in the 30s regular season. So I was kind of like, wait, you know, getting in the groove of that. So I had a really, really a lot of confidence of going into the tournament. We had a scare the first tournament game. Like it might have went into overtime or something like that, but it was shaky over there. It was against Fremont Ross, if I'm not mistaken. But we barely won that.
In the game against the Arrows, the Tigers again played just well enough to win and survive, moving them into the district rounds. The Tigers' nemesis and arch rival Malabar Falcons had rolled through the regular season undefeated, 20-0, AP ranked number one in Ohio in the AA division, beating the Tigers twice during the season.
We felt our game would take care of itself if we stuck to what we did best. We didn't really feel like we had to pull gimmicks or do anything out of the ordinary. We convinced our kids that, you know, what got us here is going to keep us here.
If the Tigers were limping into the districts, the Falcons were soaring. Pummeling their sectional opponent, Steve Miller and the Orange and Brown faced a familiar foe in the district semifinal, a team that had cut the Falcons' season short in previous seasons. The Willard Crimson Flashes, the legendary coach Bob Haas, had experience, tradition, and most notably, All-State guard Nolan Robinson.
Bob Haas, year in and year out, put arguably the best basketball program on the court at any division, at any level. And that was a tradition that, even when I started working at WMFD into the 90s, they were still pretty solid.
Well, 84-85, I remember, for, kind of ironically, the Malabar ended up beating Senior High twice that year. And Malabar was loaded, basically loaded. They the year before, they had gone 19-1 in senior high, was the only team to beat them in their regular season. So Malabar went 19-1, 20-0 back to back seasons. But it seemed like every year, those 2 years anyway, Willard was waiting. And Willard got Malabar both years, and probably, you know, if it wouldn't have been for that, I would assume Malabar would have been in Columbus, maybe even a state title or whatever in there.
The Malabar loss early in the tournament stunned the community. And as the basketball tournament continued, all of the local teams continued to bow out, leaving the Tigers as the lone North Central Ohio representative in the postseason. The Tigers began to find their stride in district play, defeating Defiance 71-68 in the semi and taking care of Port Clinton in the district finals.
And then it wasn't until we got to the districts when, you know, we are pretty good. And I think the thing for us that helped us, and we talked about this, you know, prior, is the fact that you couldn't stop just one. You know, different guys had different nights where they would score and do things, you know, that would help the team win. So you couldn't just focus on one person, because somebody else was going to get you. Whether that's me or Bubs or Am or Tyrone or Robbie, somebody's going to get you. And we almost all have to fill up the figures, and that's a rarity anyway.
As they moved to the regional semifinal, the game against Groveport would prove to be yet another challenge for the Tigers. The red and white would go on to defeat Groveport 65-61, and by this time, the entire community was behind senior high.
You know, Am took his game up. You know, Tim Horace took his game up. Whew. You know, him and Am was shooting like, it was marksman. It was crazy. Bud was just coming down the floor. I don't know what it was, man. T-Buck was getting all the rebounds. Robbie Andrews was like Charles Oakley. He was banging in the paint, everything clicked. Even the guys who came off the bench, Marcus Marks, all the guys came off the bench, everybody was clicking. And once we got into the groove and the fans saw it, they said, oh man, this could be something special. We like, man, we'll be on the bus like, man, well, this is something special. You know, I can hear Buzz and Bubba be like, nobody say nothing. We know we playing, don't say nothing. Just keep playing. And it has turned into something awesome, man. I mean, I have never in my life seen that many people following charter buses from to see how. I mean, it was like rock stars, man. It was unbelievable.
After the regional semifinal win, the boys from Mansfield came to grips with an exciting yet sobering fact. They were getting ready to play for a regional title and a chance to go to the state Final Four, for the first time since Coach E.L. Marting and the T.I. Tigers of Mansfield had won the title in 1909. The not-so-good news was they were up against one of the nation's most talented high school basketball teams, the Toledo Scott Bulldogs. They were led by All-Ohioans Chris Polonitz and Minnesota University-bound Melvin Newburn. The Tigers, on paper, were overmatched, undersized, and in most people's estimation, had reached the end of their great run in the tournament.
When we scouted the night before, they already had Toledo penciled in because they said Mansfield's nothing.
What's that game?
I'm getting chill bumps. But what's crazy is we didn't get any respect at all from Toledo. They packed it out up there with them being so close to Bowling Green. They packed it, and we couldn't. You know, we was trying to keep our composure and keep our focus, because like they covered the whole gymnasium. I mean, like, we brought a lot of people from the field, but man, no way we had the following they had, and plus they were ranked number one all year in the state. We wasn't expected to do anything against them. I mean, the odds were like, yo, this going into the next, we going to the state, you know, like that's how Toledo's mentality was, you know, these Bulldogs. And then they were intimidating because they had a mascot that was a bulldog. I mean, even though we had that tiger, but that bulldog reminded me of Georgetown, you know. Because when we were in warm-ups and how they talked to us and they chatted at us and they talked about our shoes and, man, y'all got those from Zayers. And, you know, I see the black magic marker on Bub's shoe. He's like, yo, he wouldn't even paint that. So It was bad, man. They intimidated us from the door. We were in our own zone, but we were still talking amongst ourselves, communicating, but we were nervous, man. We were all nervous.
I'm thinking we'd have made it this far. We, you know, you start the score off 0-0. For real. We ain't got down this far. I pulled them all into the locker room because a lot of the players were scared because, you know, the fans was, they was talking crazy. We go in the locker room. I said, man, you know, heck with this, man. We can beat them. I said, we can beat them. All we got to do is get off on a good start with them.
Point guard and team captain Bubba Toddy had already made his statement before the game, but now he needed to make his mark on the game. On the Tigers' first possession, Toddy took a skip pass from Tim Harless, and without hesitation, the frail and barely 6-foot point guard opens the game with an emphatic dunk over All-Ohioan Melvin Newbern.
Well, up to two steps. That was it. And they never led or anything in that game because they couldn't believe the way Bub, I guess that shocked them the way he went up and dunked the ball with those two steps, man, because it was like foul, catch, one, two, and up.
Bubba Toddy got the ball, and he just went driving down the court and slam dunked. And I can remember the Toledo Scott kids just standing around and saying, what the heck just happened?
The Toledo Scott crowd was crazy. Man, they had DJs in the stands. I mean, they're playing music, they had DJs in the stands. So when we warming up, man, they was cussing us out, calling our names. Here come Bub again, man. He said, I'm dunking on somebody off the tip. Bub changed the dynamics of the game off the tip. As soon as he dunked on Melvin Newbern, the whole Toledo Scott squad, the team stopped. But we had mad respect after that, big time.
Obviously, one of the first plays of the game, Bubba Toddy drives down, left hand slam dunk. I can remember it like it was yesterday. Just, it was everybody from Mansfield just, you know, going crazy. And I think that is kind of what catapulted us to victory that night. Just that play alone was like, okay, we're here. We're not scared of y'all. Let's get it.
You know, I'm getting the point across. I ain't never played a game scared. No. When that ball got back then, I said, I'm going up and I'm going to dunk this ball. I'm either dunking or they're going to block it or I'm going to miss it. One or the other. Because, I mean, they fans was just, man. I mean, they talk so much mess, man. And then we'd come down and be like,
Probably in my 25 years of coaching, that was probably the best played game I ever had, in the sense that they carried on the game plan perfectly. I mean, we were trapping and just playing great defense. We had them so frustrated. I mean, they had two All-State players, and we had them so frustrated that they didn't know what we were in half the time. So it wasn't even a game. Thank goodness it wasn't close, because those Toledo fans were going crazy, throwing things on the floor. Even when I asked the official, I said, could you please keep the Toledo fans off the floor? He said, I'm not going over there.
The Tigers played what the players, coaches, and fans called the best game ever by a Mansfield senior team. It wasn't even a contest. The Tigers forced over 20 turnovers and out-rebounded the Athletic Bulldogs and won the regional final game going away with a 17-point drubbing of one of the nation's top teams.
And I talked about how I thought this was the end of the line for senior high, and this guy said, don't be too sure of that. And I hadn't seen anything, as you mentioned, they barely got out of the sectional. I hadn't seen anything to suggest to me at that point that they were gonna go even as far as they had to get to the regional final. And I was sure that Scott was gonna be there. Their comeuppance, for want of a better word. They just blew them off the floor. They just blew them, what was it, 89-72, I think, was the final or something like that. I'm not confident in the score. Was it?
wow, I'm pretty good.
Almost lost in the historic victory was the fact that the Tigers were headed to the Ohio State AAA Final Four. Now the challenge was to somehow get past the win and focus on the state semifinal played at the historic St. John Arena in Columbus, Ohio. A very good North Canton Hoover team awaited the Tigers. Although they weren't as good as the Toledo Scott team, they were formidable at best. Behind sharp shooting and a team-high 19 points from Tim Harless, the Tigers put away the team from North Canton with ease, setting up a chance to bring home the state basketball championship.
It's amazing what you remember, man, at such a young age. My dad drove a gray Monte Carlo, and we drove up to the back of senior high, and I see it vividly, as strong as I'm standing here. We drove up to the ticket booth in the behind the high school, and he pulls up to the window and nobody's there. And I'm like, well, maybe we got here early enough. Nobody's here. And I figured there'd be a line out the door to get the tickets. And I jump out the car, before he can even get there, I jump out the car, I run up to the door and pull on the door and it's locked. And I look up and there is a sign on the door that says sold out. And I'm telling you right now, man. So I tell my dad, now immediately I didn't accept that. I told my dad, I said, well, we have to get the ticket somewhere else because they don't have any here. So I guess we can, I don't know how we're gonna do it, but I figured we, and he said, well, the tickets are sold out. I said, well, we just have to get them when we get down there. He said, no, there aren't any more tickets. And once that started to sink in, man, I remember being devastated to the point where I think I cried for like 2 days, man.
It was electrifying. That's the only way to describe it. State final, we'd beaten a team from Akron. I can't think of the team right now, just lost it. But anyway, it was electrifying, absolutely electrifying.
I think that was the put up or shut up game.
Welcome to St. John Arena on the Ohio State University campus in Columbia.
The Tigers would face off against Purcell Marianne High School out of Cincinnati, a team that the players and coaching staff was not that familiar with and would no doubt want to slow down the high-powered Tiger attack.
The Mansfield Sr. Tigers.
Number 34, Captain Tim Mahala. Number 32, Robbie Andrews. Number 44, Captain Tyrone Buck.
Here we are, the TY Tigers in the state finals, ready to bring home the elusive title of champion. The Tigers open the game in their aggressive man-to-man defense, and the first score of the game would prove to be a trend for the first quarter. The red and white struggled to find any consistency on offense early in the game.
Here's Robbie Andrews penetrating. And Miner off inbounds play out to Kent. Good perimeter shooter. Missed this one badly against Jackson Center. Here's Toddy from way outside. Air ball and in. Kent taken by Monty Mathis. Now going back door for Toddy. And again, Mansfield Sr. is forcing the ball.
Meanwhile, the Cavaliers were executing with precision, proving that they were up for the challenge and jumped out to an early lead.
A quick 8-0 lead in their semifinal victory over Cleveland East, and a steal on the wing, and here's Tom O'Donnell leading the fast break off to Miner, and Miner has all four of Purcell Marion's points, three over Cleveland East. Hassel out for Miner, they lead him open, and Miner is deadly from 15 feet in. This is Kiley, cross for Bledsoe. He goes low for Hassel. Pull up jump, yes. Or Rick spreads the floor. They have a 6-point lead. Hassel going low for Miner. Dave Miner with an easy two from Rick Hassel.
But the Tigers senior captain Tyrone Buck provided the play that would spark a furious second quarter run.
Down the floor to Kent, baseline for Toddy. Oh, what a beautiful alley-oop by Tyrone Buck.
falling behind 17 points in the first half, the Tigers went in at halftime only down 1 point, withstanding 20 points from Marion senior post, David Miner.
Trigger man into Miner. Dave Miner scored 20 points in the first half.
The third quarter would see both teams settle in and go back and forth like a heavyweight fight.
Sal Marion. Here is Buck now from 15 feet. Nothing but net over Miner. For O'Donnell. Miner will stick that jumper from the outside. Give it six. Harlan, 18-footer, buries it. Gets it to Hassel, though. 15-footer for Rick Hassel. Oh, he has a great release on that. Bledsoe, air ball. Here is Buck now on the quick release. Off for Kent. Hassel in low for Miner. Miner against Buck, and he scores on the reverse this time. They will have been even if they score here since the opening tip back. It is Bubba Totti on the baseline. A little shake and bake there. Ball stolen away. Frizzell breaking out. It's a Hassel cutting for the basket.
Still a close game going into the fourth quarter. The Cavaliers would begin to pull away.
He's had a great tournament. Back door to Hassel. Got it. Offense. Hassel low to Miner. Unless they get a good shot. Hassel penetrating now. Dishing off baseline. Bledsoe with a big pass.
And with just under 2 minutes left, senior leader Bubba Totti had fouled out. And the Tigers could see the title slipping away from their grasp.
But the foul is called and Miner will go to the line.
And Bubba Totti just sits in the corner of the floor, dejected because that's his fifth personal foul.
At least 4 seconds, Hassel with the basketball. He is bumped. And after the buzzer, they call it, and the Purcell Marion Cavaliers from Cincinnati are the state AAA champions, defeating Mansfield Sr. 65-57. Let's watch him celebrate.
The Tigers lost the championship game, 65-57. And although the run itself was historic, questions still linger in the thoughts and minds of the players. What more could we have done? Where did we go wrong?
The mind frame first, I think, the mind frame of us, we were there. Physically. But I don't think the mental was there. I don't think the mental was there because of all the different little executional things we should have been doing on the court, we weren't doing as we were doing earlier in the tournaments, during the tournaments.
Like I say, I ain't even been 31 years and I ain't seen the game yet. I don't want to see it. I seen 2 minutes of it and I said, oh, I ain't looking at this one. I mean, you know, we just got beat. You know, there's no excuse, you know, but I don't have, man. You know, we just... Well, I always told Coach Pratt something, and I bet you he probably don't remember. I said, I'm going to get you there, but we're going to lose. It was my exact words to him.
Now, why did you say that?
Because I just had that feeling. Wow. I just had that feeling.
So we actually got to watch. It was either Cleveland East, Cincinnati Purcell Marion. We watched them play each other. So we felt good. You know, beat North Canton Hoover, although that was another good basketball team as well, and then watched those two teams and felt we can compete with either one of these teams. Now, you know, what happened is the sad part of the story, and I think I told you this in the past, that I truly believe if we played 10 times, we win 8, but that doesn't matter. It's that moment in time. It's that opportunity you have. Do you seize it, or do you look back and go, man, that wasn't our best effort?
Head coach Joe Pratz takes plenty of accountability on himself. Turns out the Tiger coaches didn't get the most accurate information on their opponents from Southwest Ohio.
Well, we were confident. The problem was the scouting report I got was not very good. So that was probably the coach's fault. I called a couple Cincinnati coaches and they told me things that they couldn't do, that they could do when come game time. So halfway into it, we're down 16-4, I think, and the guys are looking at me. Like you said, Miner couldn't shoot out beyond 15 feet. So everything we had planned, we just said, forget it all. Let's just go out and get them. And then we cut it to 2 points at halftime. So it was just, we just didn't get a very good scouting report on them, and that was probably my fault.
Although the loss was devastating to the Tyger fans and Mansfield community, Tyger faithful would come together one last time for a rousing reception at Mansfield Sr's Pete Henry Gymnasium in honor of the team.
Oh, it was awesome. I mean, you know, there's red and white all over Mansfield. All the businesses were involved. And even, you know, even losing coming back into Mansfield, I mean, we had a motorcade and we had thousands of people just waiting for us. So that was, you know, we were all hurting because we lost it, but then when you see how people support you in defeat, it was very, very heartwarming. Yeah.
While the lore of Tyger basketball in 1985 would be forever entrenched in the hearts and minds of the Mansfield supporters, change was on the horizon for the city, and specifically for Mansfield City Schools.
Through the 80s, the enrollment declined. And to continue to provide a quality, a balanced education, advanced placement courses and college opportunity courses and those kinds of things, I think that the consolidation had to happen. I mean, if you look back, I think when I came to the district, there were about 12,000 students in the district.
Wow.
And over those years, it just dropped and dropped and dropped. And you know, where have they all gone? Well, they've gone with the jobs.
The consolidation of the two city schools, Malabar and Mansfield Senior, was not without controversy, and in some cases, without outright rebellion. Mansfield Senior High would now house the city's high school students, and the Tyger mascot would remain. But the once iconic red and white school colors would give way to the orange and brown of Malabar.
Okay, there was a vote that was taken. They had the three middle schools and the two high schools vote. The choices were Rebels, Running Rebels, Griffins, Tygers, and Falcons. But at the end of the day, when they said it was Tygers, I didn't have a problem with that. We were one community. We were one, that's how I looked at it. We were one community.
I was never going to support orange and white ever in my life. And I told my wife, because you know, she's a Falcon. She's a Malabar Falcon. And I said, I will never honor them colors ever. And then my daughter started playing basketball, and they was orange and white Tigers. And I'm walking around here in orange and white gear because my kids play, my daughters play, because there's nothing like TY red and white. I mean, nothing. There's nothing like it ever. And when they got rid of the colors, they lost me.
What do you think about the colors changing when you found out they were going to change the colors to orange and brown?
It didn't bother me.
Didn't bother you?
Like the shirt said, once a Tyger, I'm always a Tyger.
But I wear that brown shirt.
Yeah.
I got one.
After consolidation in 1989, Tyger basketball was poised to be the team to return Mansfield back to the big stage. With the talent of Malabar and Mansfield Senior combined with the basketball tradition in the city, the community could smell the success. And the 1989-90 edition of the Orange and Brown Tigers did not disappoint.
Well, people thought that it would build a power in all sports. Basketball doesn't need numbers. You know, football and the track and the other sports, you need numbers to be great. Basketball, you don't need numbers. You just need 8 or 10 guys committed. So I didn't see it helping us as much as the other sports, although that first year after combining, we had 8 lettermen coming back and a move in. So we had nine guys that had started and played a lot. So the challenge was to get nine guys to play, to get the Malabar guys to accept our system, because although they ran, they just ran. We ran in structure. So, I was excited to have all that talent. But again, it was a matter of getting the Malabar guys to pick up the Tyger method of doing things, and Falcons weren't always gracious about it, although we did fine and it all worked out. We got along well. But initially, it was a little challenging.
Loaded with a revamped roster and the Tyger coaching staff being retained, the Orange and Brown rolled to a 17-3 regular season. These Tigers came into the tournament noticeably different than the 85 red and white version. The Pratt's Cats of 1990 were state ranked and collected a number one seed in the sectional draw. The team breezed through the sectional, district, and regional semifinals. And just like deja vu all over again, an old foe awaited the Tigers in the regional final. The Toledo Scott Bulldogs returned as a powerhouse and were loaded with Division I college recruits. But unlike the night in March of 1985, the Bulldogs would not be denied. They would turn the Tigers away from what seemed to be destiny, a state tournament appearance. Over the years, Tyger basketball has seen some changes. A new school building had been erected in 2004, and the lore of the old hot Pete Henry Gymnasium was gone. Coach Joe Pratz had retired as head coach of the Tigers in 1993 with over 200 wins. The program has continued on successfully and ultimately did reach Columbus again in 1999 and 2005, led by new head coach Greg Collins. All told, since the infamous championship run in 1985, the Tiger program has accumulated two additional Final Four appearances, two regional titles, four district championships, and multiple district final appearances. Now ranked as Ohio's fourth winningest team, Mansfield Sr. has established Tyger basketball as one of the most recognizable and revered programs in the Buckeye State. Although many will never forget the Pratt's Cats of the mid-80s, the foundation was laid by many great Tiger teams of the past. From Tiger legends Ken McCauley, to Jerry Hollebrand, to Bobby Taylor, Eric Bubba Toddy, to Marquise Sykes, and Keon Johnson, the mantle has been passed to today's generation.
What is Tiger basketball? What does that mean?
Family. That's one of the first words that comes to mind is family. Once you're a Tiger, you're always a Tiger. So family is huge, and tradition is another word that comes to mind. We are the fourth winningest program in the state of Ohio. And I say that anytime somebody will listen, because that's a big deal to me. Only three schools can say that they've won more basketball games than us.
In achieving that goal, it brought in so many other things. Like you say, the community involvement, the excitement, putting Mansfield basketball back on the map, making people proud to wear the red and white. So it just brought a lot of pride to Mansfield that we needed. It gave people something to get excited about in the black and white community. So it brought people together. I mean, the community followed us, and you saw the stands full of blacks and whites yelling for a common goal. And that's meant a lot to me now that I look back.
You know, we love who we were. We didn't care what people thought. You know, when you come play against us, you know what I mean? You know you fought the TY Tigers. It was no doubt about it. When you left there, you might have won, but you had some scars, because it's going to be a fight.
Tiger basketball was, or is, it is still. It's playing hard, and sometimes it's not always measured by what the scoreboard says. It's how you carry yourself, how hard you play, and be reflective of the community, knowing that you're just not playing for you and your boys that are on the court right then and there. You're playing for everybody in those stands that made it possible for you to be there. You know, to play for those guys who played in 82, 83, even before then, who had rough times, you know, play for 85, 86, those dudes that you looked up to, as well as to understand that you're playing for your family who were taking you back and forth, who, you know, sacrificing to buy shoes, everything else, your dad working overtime, you know, to make sure you have things that you need on the basketball court. So yeah, you might miss a shot, you might lose a game, but it's that effort and that pride and to represent all that stuff, and that's the payback for the players on the court, that you gotta play hard. You have no choice, you know, let alone for one another that's on the court, but for everybody that has sacrificed before you and for then now for you to be here in this position, you know, you gotta go out and play. And to know the sacrifice that people have made for you to be on that court. And it's a privilege.
Usually, the end of a great story has a happy ending. And sports stories almost always have the good guys winning the big game in the end. And although Mansfield Sr. still has not won the elusive state championship, the happily ever after in this story lies in the eyes of the new Tiger. This new generation is responsible to play for the honor of our school, our community, and most of all, represent the TY. Because in Mansfield, Ohio, the TY stands for the community, and the Mansfield community has always stood for the TY.
What's it mean to you personally to wear Tigers across your chest?
It means everything. I've been wanting to play here ever since I was little. Sitting on the sideline with my dad, watching Jalen Watson and Fatty go at it against people. I mean, I've been wanting to go here my whole life. I mean, it's a dream come true. Play varsity on this team.
It's the culture. It's the culture around here. It's fourth winningest team in Ohio. It's an honor to play, honestly.
It means a lot. I grew up watching Tyger basketball. I've been a Tyger all my life. So yeah, it really means a lot to me.
I'm a Tyger through and through. I've been red and white Tiger. I was one that hated Malabar and into the transition to orange and brown in the 89-90 year. And obviously it's my alma mater. I played here. I've been coaching here about 13 years, so it's my life. I am a Tiger and I love it.
How would you describe Tiger basketball? What is it?
A lot of speed, fast, athleticism. You see a lot of pressure defense, a lot of great ball handling, great passing. It's real fast paced, real up tempo basketball.
When you think about Tiger basketball, you think about just the legacy of grittiness, toughness, competitiveness, athletes who really get after it, and just exhibit the heart that kind of is indicative of the city within itself.